Thank you so much for that extremely kind introduction and for the invitation to visit your program here. It's a program I've held in awe for many years as I've gotten to know many of the faculty through the AAS and SUS. Here's my disclosures. So it's a huge honor to come to University of Wisconsin. It's a phenomenal academic program. And as Dr. Aker just alluded to, just to put it in perspective, Sharon Weber is the outgoing president of the SUS at last week's Academic Surgical Congress. And then on the AAS side, Caprice Greenberg is the brand new president, and then Becky Sipple is the president-elect. So to have three presidents from your institution 3 years in a row at these organizations is a real testament to the strength of the academic program here. And of course, that's just the tip of the academic iceberg here. There's so many of you that I've gotten to know over the years of leadership roles in the AAS and the SUS, as well as in the Journal of Surgical Research. And it's a real tribute to what a high-powered academic institution this is. One of my new roles is as editor-in-chief of Journal of Surgical Research. This is the old cover of JSR. And some of you know that we've been recently working on redesigning the cover, and with such amazing contributions from the University of Wisconsin in the leadership of this journal, as well as, of course, the contributions to this journal, this was one of the finalists for the new cover, and I think it would have served the journal very well. I also want to acknowledge Dr. Aker and his sort of role in my interest in clinical research, particularly related to complex aortic surgery. And this is one of the papers that I came across when I was just getting out of residency, and it was a novel paper in that it looked at creating a model for better understanding the risk factors related to development of paraplegia and paraparesis after thoracoabdominal aortic repair. Up until that time, everybody was just sort of reporting their own case series and making claims about how one technique might be better than another by comparing their series with others. But there was no risk adjustment between those series. And we all talk about risk adjustment now, it's just sort of part of our culture, but this is 25 years ago and nobody was doing that. The concept of an O to E ratio was completely unheard of back then. And Dr. Aker really led the way in sort of developing a model to predict the number of spinal cord deficits in these patients based on the differences in extensive repair, the number of patients with acute presentations, the number of patients with dissection, and showed that depending on the ratio of those different factors in different series, that would strongly impact the different incidence of spinal cord injury. And it's still a classic today. He's sort of modified that over the years and continues to use this ODE ratio as a way of evaluating his own outcomes. And many of us around the country use that model to look at our outcomes as well. So this is way ahead of its time in terms of looking at and modeling outcomes. And so I really appreciate his contributions to this field. So as you know, my interest is in aortic disease. We look both at aneurysms and dissections, just showing a fusiform aneurysm formed in the ascending aorta. The even more lethal form of the disease is acute aortic dissection, shown here as a tear in the ascending aorta, then propagating down through the aortic arch. This can also be localized to the descending thoracic aorta, as shown here in this fusiform aneurysm. And of course, there are dissections involving the descending aorta propagating down the length of the aorta into the abdominal region, creating this true and false lumen, which not only leaves you with a weak outer aortic wall that is prone to dilatation and rupture, but because of differences in flow related to the dissecting membrane and the false lumen can lead to ischemia of really any of the organs fed from branch vessels from the aorta. So this has been the area of my focus ever since my first research projects at Northwestern. Aortic disease kills more than 10,000 people in the United States every year. It's one of the top 10 leading causes of death of men over the age of 50. And as Dr. Aker alluded to, there's a lot known about the understanding pathobiology of genetically triggered aortic disease, but relatively little known about sporadic disease, which accounts for about 80% of the cases. So this shows an sort of extreme version of aortic disease with a descending thoracic aortic dissection that's then led to progressive dilatation of the thoracoabdominal aorta. Many of the pioneering work in how to repair these operations occurred in Houston, and so it was a great privilege for me to be able to train and then stay on at Baylor as faculty, which was sort of the epicenter of the development of these operations. And so what I joined in 1999, I had a very busy clinical practice focused on these repairs, and also a fair amount of clinical research focused on how to improve outcomes with these sorts of repairs. But what was missing is any effort to understand the pathobiology of the disease. And so I was asked to form a basic science project that would then lead to a better understanding of the disease. So much of the pioneering work in aortic disease, of course, was done by Dr. DeBakey, and then particularly related to the thoracoabdominal aorta and aortic arch, then by Dr. Stanley Crawford, who Dr. Aker spent time with, and then Dr. Crawford, one of Dr. Crawford's mentees is Joe Caselli, who is my boss and has been my mentor ever since residency. So when I came aboard, I began building a basic science program that would complement and eventually be highly integrated with our clinical enterprise, and that's been very fruitful. So if there's a message to the trainees in terms of developing your research program, partnering with clinical investigators that have strong, high-volume centers of excellence is one of the keys, I think, to success. And so trying to marry your basic science interests with your clinical strengths, I think, is one of the keys to developing a good program. And this is the overall paradigm we tried to create, and where we knew we would be taking samples from patients who were undergoing operations and using those samples for our research. And so we developed a tissue bank very early on. As one of the first things I did as junior faculty, is establish a tissue bank so we could collect aortic samples as well as blood samples from all of our patients. These became key to experiments you'll see today, as well as others involving biomarkers and genetics. So we then use these to study the molecular biology of the abnormal tissues or blood samples, and then based on those findings there, take them into animal models in an attempt to identify potential targets for treatment. Of course, the ultimate hope is to bring that back to patients, and we haven't quite completed that last arrow yet, but I think I'll show you that the other parts of the paradigm have worked quite well. So the key goal of our lab is to better understand the pathobiology of thoracic aortic aneurysms and dissections in hope of identifying new avenues for treatment. So I thought what I'd talk about today is this notion of the importance of a balance between the mechanisms for aortic wall protection and repair versus the destructive factors that relate to hemodynamic stress and other issues affecting the aortic wall, and that it's really an imbalance between the destructive factors and the aortic repair factors that then leads to aortic disease. This propagates vascular smooth muscle cell loss, extracellular matrix destruction, aortic wall degeneration, and eventually aneurysm and dissection formation. So it's really this imbalance that's sort of the key issue. There's a lot of attention paid to the destructive factors, and we'll touch on some of that today, but fairly little known about what mechanisms are in place to protect the aortic wall. And so while it's interesting to think about why do some people develop aneurysms, the counter question is also very important, is why do certain people who are clearly at risk not develop aortic aneurysms and dissections, and what mechanisms might be helping to protect the aortic wall from degeneration. So the first, I thought I would go through sort of four different factors, two on the destructive side and two on the repair side. And so the first one I'll talk about is the inflammasome. So the inflammasome is a multi-protein complex that's plays a critical role in the cell's response to stress. And the three key components of the NLRP3 inflammasome complex are NLRP3, ASC, and procaspase 1, which becomes activated caspase 1 and produces a lot of downstream effects. So cellular stress from a variety of issues will trigger the assembly and activation of the inflammasome complex, which then activates caspase 1 and leads to a series of events that initiates the inflammatory response through the maturation of cytokines and other mechanisms. So understanding its key role in inflammation and cell response to stress, we wondered whether the inflammasome might play a role in the development of aortic aneurysms and dissections. So we, as with all these experiments I'll show you today, we started with the patient samples to look at whether or not there was a hint that they might be involved. And so what I'm showing here is a comparison between thoracic aortic aneurysm samples, it's TAA, thoracic aortic dissection cases, TAD, and then control samples taken from patients who are organ donors without aortic disease. And the Westerns show that there's a marked increase in the levels of NLRP3 as well as the pro and active forms of caspase 1 in the aortic samples from disease patients compared to controls. Further, we see that there's a marked expression of NLRP3 in both smooth muscle cells as well as in macrophages. So this was our first hint that that might be something worth looking at. Now, one of the caveats is the aortic tissue from our patients is all end-stage disease. And so while it can hint at an association, it really only tells you what's happening after the aneurysm has formed. So what it doesn't tell you is, did this contribute to aneurysm formation, or is this merely a response to the aneurysm in the abnormal environment of the aortic wall? We also found in the samples from patients that NLRP3 and caspase 1 co-localize with MMP9. MMP9 is a key protease involved in aortic damage. So this co-localization suggests that there might be some interaction between the inflammasome and MMP9, which is a key factor in destruction of the aortic extracellular matrix. So we did some cell culture experiments showing that NLRP3 inhibition reduces MMP9 level expression from those cells. So shown here is cells, vascular smooth muscle cells stimulated with palmitic acid, which induces a strong oxidative stress on the cells, and you can see that that stress increases expression of NLRP3 as well as activation of MMP9. However, when treating the cells with silencing RNA for NLRP3, there's a diminished level of NLRP3 and a silencing of activation of MMP9, again suggesting that NLRP3 and the inflammasome complex may have some role in activating this key protease. So we, based on this, we hypothesized that the inflammasome played an important role in activating MMP9 and perhaps other proteases, leading to this pathway of extracellular matrix destruction, aortic damage, and aneurysm and dissection formation. And therefore, the inflammasome might actually represent a target to prevent aortic disease. So we then move from this tissue-based, patient-based hypothesis-driving experiment to looking at these in more detail using mouse models. So one of our key mouse models is infusion of angiotensin II coupled with a high-fat diet. And in these animals, they develop severe aortic disease. And so 8 weeks of high-fat diet plus 4 weeks of angiotensin II infusion results in a high incidence of aortic aneurysm and dissection in mice. This shows a ruptured thoracoabdominal portion of the aorta in a mouse that died. This was the specimen from that mouse, and you can appreciate with the white arrow the destruction of the suprarenal abdominal aorta. This was the site of rupture, but also notice that the mouse shown in the yellow arrow had dissection forming in the ascending and transverse aortic arch as well. And then when you look at histology of the abdominal segment, you can see the sort of classic dissection with a true lumen, a false lumen with thrombosis. So when we took these mice that had been challenged with high-fat diet and angiotensin II infusion and looked at their aortas, we found similar increases in all of the elements of the inflammasome complex, NLRP3, ASC, and caspase 1, in those aortas, in contrast to the normal aortas from untreated, unchallenged mice. Further, we used a proximity ligation assay to show that there is potential interaction between MMP9 and the inflammasome complex in the aortic wall of these mice, again, corresponding with what we've seen in the patient samples. So it turns out that gliburide is actually a fairly potent inhibitor of the inflammasome complex. The exact mechanism isn't completely understood, but it may be related to its interaction with the potassium channels, which is sort of a key trigger for inflammasome activation. So knowing that it's an inhibitor of the inflammasome, we wondered whether gliburide might work as a preventative measure against aortic disease. So we first conducted some cell culture experiments and showed that, first of all, as with the previous experiment, stimulation of the cells with palmitic acid would increase the expression of NLRP3 and other components of the inflammasome complex. And then in a dose-dependent manner, treating those cells with gliburide reduced the expression of NLRP3 and reduced the activation of caspase 1. So we then went back to the animal model. In this case, we took wild-type animals that had a high-fat diet. They then received gavage with either gliburide or water beginning on week 5. And then beginning on week 8, they received their angiotensin 2 infusions. Pretty large groups of animals to confirm what are pretty exciting findings. So this shows you the degree of destruction and aneurysm formation in the animals challenged with high-fat diet and angiotensin II, with extensive aneurysm involving the ascending arch and extending down through the thoracoabdominal aorta. In contrast, the animals treated with gliburide, although they still have a degree of aortic dilatation, we did not see the severe incidence of dilatation that we found in the untreated animals. And the incidence of aneurysm or dissection here, where we're defining aneurysm as a dilatation 1.5 times that of the normal aorta, was 71% in the untreated mice versus 31% in the mice that received gliburide. This degree of reduction of aortic disease was seen in all of the segments of the aorta, including the ascending and the infrarenal abdominal portions. Further, we looked at whether what the response of NLRP3 in the aortic wall was to gliburide treatment using immunofluorescence staining, and show that the treatment with gliburide markedly reduced the expression of NLRP3 in the aortic walls from these mice. Similarly, the mice treated with gliburide had marked reduction in MMP9 expression in their aortic walls, again suggesting that gliburide may have a protective effect on the aortic wall through its inhibition of the inflammasome and that in the reduction of reduction of MMP activity. This is in situ zymography, so rather than looking at the abundance of MMP9 in the wall, this actually looks at activity of the protease in the wall, and you can see a marked reduction in MMP9 expression in the animals treated with gliburide, shown in the right column, compared to the untreated controls shown in the left, where that dense area of green beyond the beyond the autofluorescence from the elastic fibers exhibits a marked increase in MMP9 activity, which was essentially negated by treatment with gliburide. So we believe the inflammasome works through MMP9 to affect extracellular matrix destruction, aortic biomechanical failure, and aneurysm and dissection. Now, we also think that there are other mechanisms involved with the inflammasome because it can have so many effects downstream. And one of those I'm not going to go into today in the interest of time is the effect of the inflammasome on the contractile elements of the smooth muscle cells in the aortic wall. So there's been a lot of attention paid to proteases and the destruction of the aortic wall, but increasing knowledge from the patients that have genetically triggered aortic disease of the role of the smooth muscle cells in the process and sort of abnormal contractile response of those cells creates a situation where the aortic wall does not respond appropriately to hemodynamic stress. And so we did a series of experiments looking at whether the inflammasome actually interacts with the smooth muscle cell contractile proteins, and found that there's substantial degradation of those proteins when the inflammasome is activated, and that this leads to biomechanical dysfunction. So it's another mechanism whereby inflammasome may lead to aneurysm and dissection formation. So that's the inflammasome. Then the next negative destructive factor I thought I'd talk about is ADAMTS, which is it's another protease. It's a whole family of proteases that degrade all of the elements of the extracellular matrix. And we focused on a couple of key ADAMTS family members, 1 and 4, because of their involvement in other forms of cardiovascular disease. So again, we started with the patient samples. And what we found was that the samples from patients with aneurysms and dissections had markedly higher abundance of ADAMTS1 and ADAMTS4 compared to controls. Furthermore, through double staining, we were able to show that ADAMTS4 and 1 were produced by vascular smooth muscle cells and macrophages in the diseased aneurysm tissue. Furthermore, the key substrate of ADAMTS is versican, which is a large proteoglycan, and it's a key component of the aortic wall extracellular matrix. So we looked at whether there was evidence of versican degradation in the aortic tissues from these patients and found high levels of versican degradation products in the samples from both aneurysm and dissection patients. And when we correlated the levels of ADAMTS1 or 4 in those aortic samples, we found a strong level correlation between increasing levels of ADAMTS and increasing levels of degradation products of versican. We then did cell culture experiments and a transwell assay to look at the role of ADAMTS on macrophage invasion. All of the proteases, as you know, play a role in various diseases related to inflammatory cell migration and cancer metastasis because of their ability to break down extracellular matrix as cells infiltrate tissues. And so this was an experiment to look at what the role of ADAMTS in macrophage invasion. And you see here the stimulation with TGF-beta in the top right leads to marked migration of macrophages through the assay, and that this was substantially reduced when the cells were treated with silencing RNA for ADAMTS4. Based on the cell work and the patient-based data, we then conducted a series of mouse experiments to look at the role of ADAMTS4 in preventing aortic aneurysms and dissection. So we had two groups of mice, wild-type mice and ADAMTS4 knockout mice. Both groups of these mice were then subdivided into groups, one of which received the high-fat diet and angiotensin II challenge. So this is our challenged wild-type group, as well as our challenged ADAMTS-deficient group. And then the controls received normal diet and saline infusion rather than angiotensin II. So these are our unchallenged control groups, both again in the wild-type and ADAMTS-4 knockout backgrounds. This shows the extent of disease in the challenged animals, with the first red rectangle showing the severe disease that formed in the challenged mice in the wild-type background. And you can appreciate that there's disease in the knockout on the right as well, but much more limited in terms of the extent of and severity of the disease. And when we looked at the incidence of aneurysm or dissection in the wild-type versus the knockout groups, there were 77% incidence in the wild-type group versus 37% in the knockout group. So a partial effect related to genetic deficiency in just one of the ADAMTS family members. Further, when we looked at the aortic walls to look at the level of apoptosis, we found that in the unchallenged mice, including those with ADAMTS knockout, there is essentially no apoptosis is indicated by the absence of the red staining for tunnel. However, in the challenged mice in the top right, you can see a marked increase in apoptosis related to aortic wall destruction, whereas in the ADAMTS4 knockout mice, a substantial reduction in the level of apoptosis in the aortic walls. Similarly, there's a reduction in macrophages, with essentially no macrophages seen in the unchallenged mice, whereas you had extensive infiltration with macrophages in the wild-type challenged mice, but this was substantially reduced with the knockout of ADAMTS4 shown on the bottom right. Similarly, ADMTS4 deficiency reduced mouse macrophage invasion. So this is looking at the mouse macrophages from these animals, and you can see the marked increase in invasion stimulated with interleukin-1. However, in the ADMTS4 knockout cells, a marked reduction in the ability for the macrophages to infiltrate the aortic wall. So based on this, we believe that the ADMTS may play a critical role in the development of aneurysms and dissection through extracellular matrix destruction, its role in regulating apoptosis, and its role in inflammatory cell infiltration, and therefore may also be a pharmacologic target. It turns out that pentosan polysulfate sodium is a drug that's used for interstitial cystitis and also used heavily for horses with osteoarthritis and is a strong inhibitor of ADMTS. So we're currently using this drug in our mouse model to investigate whether delivering this drug might reduce the risk of aneurysms in those mice. It's something that's ongoing in our lab now. So that covers two what we think are key destructive factors that serve as mechanisms for this pathway from stress of the aortic wall down through aortic dilatation and dissection. So now I thought I'd shift gears a little bit and look at mechanisms for protection and repair. And again, the hope here is that these destructive factors may actually serve as targets, and through drug discovery, we might be able to come up with ways of reducing the effect of these destructive factors on the aortic wall. So in terms of mechanisms for protection and repair, one of the first things we were interested in is what's the role of stem cells in the aortic wall. When the aortic wall is injured and has ongoing hemodynamic stress and you start to have deterioration of the extracellular matrix, how does the body respond to that? And what's the roles of stem cells in going to the aortic wall and trying to repair that damage and prevent further damage? So again, starting with the patient tissue, we first did staining looking at several markers for different types of stem cells and found that there were high levels of these markers in the aortic wall from patients with thoracic aortic aneurysms and with thoracic aortic dissection. And that furthermore, these cells appear to differentiate into relevant cell types. So we used double staining looking at both the markers for stem cells as well as the markers for smooth muscle cells showing in the top or fibroblasts showing in the bottom column. And double staining suggests that there are cells that express both these markers, suggesting that the stem cells that have traveled to the aorta are now differentiating into smooth muscle cells and fibroblasts, which are key response cells in terms of trying to abrogate the negative effects of aortic wall damage. So we took this information and then asked the question whether stem cells in the diseased aortic wall derive from bone marrow. So what wasn't clear is how many of these stem cells were actually just resident stem cells versus how many have actually come and been attracted to the damaged aortic wall from the bone marrow. And so we conducted a series of experiments looking at the contribution of bone marrow-derived cells to the aortic wall in the setting of aortic injury. And so what we did is we took mice with GFP-labeled cells and then injected their bone marrow cells into irradiated wild-type recipients. So these mice now have bone marrow cells that are labeled with fluorescent green protein. Those animals were then treated either with a high-fat diet and angiotensin II infusion, so this is our challenged group, or they received normal diet and saline infusion, so our unchallenged control group. This just shows the blood pressure in the challenged and the unchallenged mice to give you a sense of the degree of hypertension that the angiotensin II infusion creates. And you can see substantial and sustained hypertension in the animals receiving angiotensin II plus high-fat diet. So we think we like this model because it's almost the perfect Western model for cardiovascular disease. You've got high-fat diet and hypertension. The only thing we're missing here is smoking. And if we could get these mice to smoke, it'd be like the perfect model for a Western aortic disease. So, but we get high levels of hypertension, so high levels of aortic stress. This shows the aorta from one of the mice in the normal diet, uninfused animal. So this is the normal aorta. In contrast, this is the aorta from the animals that have been treated with high-fat diet and angiotensin II, extensive aneurysm involving the ascending aorta extending through the descending into the abdominal aorta. One of the things I don't like about this model is that it completely spares the infrarenal abdominal aorta, which I think speaks to the different pathogenesis of those two diseases. And it's interesting to me that the abdominal aorta is generally spared in this model. But at any rate, you know, you see these little areas of hematoma. They don't develop classic dissection in the way we see dissection in patients. The animals just don't survive that long. They get these little hematomas in the aortic wall, and those that then go on to a bigger dissection, they actually rupture and die. So this is naive of me, and this shows one of my sort of mistakes when I put together my first grant, is I was hoping to show that drugs could inhibit dilatation in animals with chronic dissection. And so my thought was, if we get animals with chronic dissection, we could then start treatment and see whether we could prevent aneurysm formation in those animals with chronic dissection. The fact of the matter is that none of them develop chronic dissection. They all go on to rupture and die. They do get these little focal hematomas, though, but these hematomas have the classic sort of true lumen and thrombosed false lumen seen in human aortic dissection. So this was an experiment then to look at whether or not bone marrow cells were recruited to the aortic wall after the aortic wall challenge. And so this is aortic wall from the unchallenged mice. And you see the autofluorescence green there is for the elastic fibers, but there are no green cells within the aortic wall. So the unchallenged aorta is not recruiting cells from the bone marrow. In contrast, in the animals that are stressed with angiotensin II and high-fat diet, even without aortic dissection, you can see marked increase in green staining in the aortic wall, particularly in the areas of the media and the adventitia. And then this is from a mouse that did have aortic dissection, and you can again see high levels of green cells in the aortic wall. So this suggests that in the presence of aortic wall stress that leads to degeneration, there's recruitment of cells from the bone marrow. Some of those cells are going to be inflammatory cells. Some of those cells are likely to be stem cells. This is just the quantification of the GFP-positive cells in the aortic wall, showing significant elevation in the challenged mice. We then did double staining to look to see how many of these, or whether these bone marrow-derived cells, whether they had any markers of stem cells. And so double staining here with SCA1 shows that there are some bone marrow-derived stem cells in the aortic wall, particularly in the adventitia. Some of these cells also are can be shown to differentiate into fibroblasts through double staining with FSP1. And these cells, when they get to the aortic wall, secrete a variety of growth factors that are important in remodeling of the aortic wall. So this showing that the GFP-positive cells are expressing VEGF, similarly IGF-1, and platelet-derived growth factor as well. So the cells are attracted from the bone marrow. They go to the damaged aortic wall. Some of them will differentiate into fibroblasts and smooth muscle cells, and some of them will express a variety of growth factors that are important in vessel repair. So we think fairly solid evidence that there's this repair mechanism that the stressed aorta is exposed to. The last factor I thought I'd talk about today is AKT. As a protective factor. So AKT is a serine threonine protein kinase. It's involved in a lot of different cellular processes, and we became interested in it because it has diverse cellular protective functions and has been shown in cardiovascular disease to provide protection. And also there's a lot of correlation with metabolic syndrome and diabetes and some of the similarities in the vessel wall response to those diseases triggered a thought that it might have a role in aortic aneurysm formation. So we asked the question, does AKT provide protection against aortic aneurysms and dissections? Again, I think I'm beating this to death, but we started with the samples from our patients. And what we found is when we looked at thoracic aneurysm, thoracic dissection samples, there was substantial reduction in AKT signaling as shown as reduced phosphorylated AKT levels in the patient-derived samples. So we used AKT knockout mice to examine its effect on the aortic wall under stress. And you can see the wild-type animals, relatively normal-appearing aorta, even under the challenge of a low-dose angiotensin II infusion. This is a little bit different model. Our model has evolved to now using the high-fat diet to sort of increase the severity of aortic disease. But one of our earlier models was just a low-dose angiotensin II infusion, which in normal mice doesn't produce aortic disease, although a little bit of mild dilatation perhaps, is shown by that second aorta. However, you can see in the knockout mouse, those animals develop substantial disease involving the aorta with, again, this sort of classic dissection with a true lumen and a thrombosed false lumen. And the incidence of aneurysms and dissection was 70% in this group of animals in the AKT non-mice challenged with low-dose angiotensin II infusion versus no aneurysms or dissections in the other groups. Furthermore, the disease affected all of the segments of the aorta, particularly in the ascending aorta and the suprarenal segment of the abdominal aorta. We felt this is pretty interesting in that the lower left is an AKT null mice that was not stressed with angiotensin II. And I think you can appreciate the elastic fibers shown with the dark wavy structures shown with the elastin staining is a bit disorganized and not normal as it appears in the upper left, suggesting that AKT has some role in the development of these elastic fibers and maintenance of the normal architecture. So already in the AKT null mice, we're seeing abnormalities of the aortic wall. But then under stress, we get marked destruction of the elastic fibers that coincided with the severe nature of the aortic disease. Furthermore, we looked at the effect of the AKT deficiency on macrophage invasion with staining of CD68, and you can see there was a substantial increase in the number of macrophages in the AKT null mice that were challenged with angiotensin II. We also looked at MMP9 expression, and as expected in the AKT null mice, we found high levels of MMP9 exhibited in the immunohistochemical staining of the walls of the aortas from these mice in contrast to the other groups. So based on this work and other experiments that dug a little bit deeper into the interaction of AKT with FOXO1, which is a transcription factor that plays a key role in protease expression, we feel that AKT works through FOXO1 to enable a situation where MMP9 is relatively downregulated and TIMP1, which is one of the key inhibitors of MMP9, is upregulated. So you have a nice balance between inhibitors and proteases. This leads to prevention of extracellular matrix destruction and inhibition of inflammation and therefore resistance to aneurysm and dissection formation. However, when you remove AKT from the picture, you lose its interaction with FOXO1. You get more promiscuous entry of FOXO1 into the nucleus and upregulation of MMP9 expression, decreased expression of TIMP1, leading to extracellular matrix destruction and uninhibited inflammation, eventually leading to aneurysm, a high susceptibility for aneurysm and aortic dissection. We published this work a couple of years ago in Circulation Research. But again, you know, like sepsis and so many other things, it's never just one pathway and one mechanism. And so some of our newer work is now looking at how AKT works through regulating bone marrow cell-mediated aortic homeostasis. And so we wondered whether AKT may be playing a role in the regulation of bone marrow-derived cells and those response to aortic wall degeneration. So this series of mouse experiments, we again took wild-type mice that had fluorescently labeled bone marrow cells. Transferred those bone marrow cells to irradiated wild-type recipients. And then we had an unchallenged group that received saline infusion for 4 weeks. So this is an unchallenged wild-type group. A second group that received angiotensin II at fairly low dose for 4 weeks. So this is our challenged wild-type bone marrow transplant group. And then our third group is we took a set of AKT-deficient mice and harvested their GFP-positive bone marrow cells and then injected those into wild-type recipients. So these these wild-type recipients now have bone marrow cells that are not only labeled with GFP but are deficient in AKT2, to see what the role of AKT2 is in the response of those bone marrow cells to aortic wall damage. So we then challenged these mice with angiotensin II. So this third group is the challenged AKT deficient bone marrow transplant group. This is the data from our flow cytometry, just showing that we had 98% reconstitution of the bone marrow in the animals that received bone marrow transplantation. These are the diameters of each of the five main segments of the aorta in the wild-type bone marrow transplant recipients that were unchallenged, and you can see fairly normal, and that fairly normal reduction in diameter as you progress from the ascending aorta on the left to the inferior abdominal aorta on the right. Now, the challenged animals that receive wild-type bone marrow had a significant increase in diameter, but is very mild, so although statistically significant, you can see the degree of dilatation isn't very impressive. And more importantly, in this group of animals, there were no dissections or aneurysms. Now, in contrast, in the challenged mice that received bone marrow that was deficient in AKT2, there was marked dilatation of each of the aortic segments, and 64% of these animals developed aneurysms and dissection. So that's the diameter data here, showing you now the gross appearance of the aorta in the saline-infused wild-type bone marrow transplant animals. This shows you the dilatation involving nearly all of the segments of the aorta that was seen in the challenged mice that received wild-type bone marrow. But again, this level of dilatation didn't reach the threshold of aneurysm formation, and we didn't see any hematomas in the aortic wall suggestive of dissection. In contrast, this is aorta from one of the animals that received angiotensin II infusion after receiving AKT2 deficient bone marrow. And you can see marked destruction of the aorta. This animal actually died of a ruptured thoracoabdominal portion of the aneurysm. And you see 9 of the 14 animals developed severe disease. This shows the role or the association between AKT deficient bone marrow and the elastic fiber architecture. And so, as you'd expect, even in the wild type bone marrow transplant recipients, with stress from angiotensin II, there's abnormal elastic fiber architecture here. You don't have the sort of dense waviness and compact nature of the elastic fibers that you would expect. But this was substantially exacerbated in the animals that were deficient, had bone marrow transplant with lacking AKT2. We then did a series of immunofluorescence staining showing that the recipients of AKT-deficient bone marrow had diminished recruitment of bone marrow cells. So here's an unchallenged aortic wall from an unchallenged mouse that received wild-type bone marrow, and you can see an absence of any of the green staining GFP-positive bone marrow cells. In contrast, they challenged mice that had wild-type bone marrow, marked response with the influx of bone marrow-derived cells into the aortic wall, particularly in the adventitia in response to the stress. However, in the animals that had bone marrow deficient in AKT, a marked reduction in that response and much fewer cells present from bone marrow in the aortic wall. And this shows the quantification of that immunofluorescence experiment. Again, showing the increase in recruitment of bone marrow-derived cells in the face of challenge with hemodynamic stress, but that's markedly reduced in the setting of bone marrow that's deficient in AKT. Similarly, we found in terms of the types of cells there that there were fewer bone marrow-derived progenitor cells in the aortic walls of the animals that had AKT-deficient bone marrow. And so the progenitor cells are key in the response to aortic or any vascular injury and initiating the repair process. So this suggests that there's not only fewer cells going to the aortic wall in the absence of AKT2, but also that the number of cells that then transfer, become progenitor cells and begin the vascular repair process are diminished. Similarly, we found that the animals with deficient AKT2 bone marrow had fewer aortic fibroblasts present in the aortic wall. And these were the bone marrow derived fibroblasts that were diminished. We then did a series of cell culture experiments looking at the effect of these bone marrow cells on smooth muscle cell response to oxidative stress. So when we take aortic smooth muscle cells and treat them with hydrogen peroxide, it leads to marked apoptosis as shown by the red tunnel staining in those cells. However, if you co-culture those cells with wild type bone marrow cells and then subject them to stress with hydrogen peroxide, you get a marked reduction in the number of apoptotic cells, suggesting that the bone marrow cells are helping to diminish the effect of apoptosis. So finally, when we then co-cultured the smooth muscle cells with bone marrow cells that were deficient in AKT2, we saw a return of the apoptotic cells, again shown in the red, with a marked increase compared to that seen with the wild-type bone marrow cells. And then this is the quantification of that experiment, with the white bars showing you the cells that were stimulated with hydrogen peroxide, the marked reduction in the presence of wild-type bone marrow cells, but how that the loss of AKT2 partially diminished that protective effect of the bone marrow cells. So from this series of experiments, we concluded that AKT2 in the bone marrow cells prevents aneurysms and dissections in the mice challenged with low-dose angiotensin II infusion. And this may occur through several mechanisms, including promoting bone marrow cell recruitment, activating progenitor cells and fibroblasts, and preventing apoptosis. So this suggests that AKT plays a key role in as a mechanism for protection of the aortic wall and prevention of aneurysm and dissection, along with stem cells. So two potential protective mechanisms that are helping prevent aortic disease in the face of hemodynamic stress, and that sort of counterbalancing with two destructive factors that we believe may be essential targets going forward. So I hope I've shared with you a little bit about how we've tried to integrate a basic science program with our clinical and our clinical research programs, and I hope, particularly for the residents in the audience, that it shows you kind of this paradigm of, if you've got access to the patients and their samples, and you can ask interesting questions, you can use those as a way of deriving your basic science program, identifying potential targets in patient-based samples, and then taking those through molecular biology and animal models to try to further refine those targets and look for potential avenues for treatment. So with that, I want to acknowledge my many collaborators and mentors, and I have to particularly acknowledge Dr. Shen, who's an MD-PhD that runs my lab. She's been with me the whole time, and she's really the brains behind all of the science and just a terrific partner. This is the group of my lab members over the years that we were doing these experiments. And again, I want to particularly acknowledge Ping-Ping Ren, who's a current postdoc fellow in our lab, and then Daryl Wu, who's a general surgery resident, spent 3 years in our lab and is currently applying for a cardiothoracic surgery training. So with that, thank you very much for the honor to come visit your fantastic program and share a little bit of our work with you. Thank you.